14, 15, I started to go to the shows. One thing I remember was coming home blown away. I mean, having that thing in the back of your spine just flipping out and just going crazy. And I remember when I got in my first band, I said, I want to do that every single night to whomever is coming.
My father always messed around the house with a guitar. I used to think he could play until I got old enough to realize he was faking.
Put us on a stage and we'll perform.
Baseball players, like football players, are Catholic. I think before they go on the field, before they go out to the ring, they usually do the sign of the cross, maybe they say a prayer. That's what I do.
Yeah, it is aggressive and crazy. But bottom line, we're here to have a good time. The audience is here to have a good time.
Rock and roll! New Zealand, it's nice to be here. At last, Twisted Sister has arrived in New Zealand. Now, I was here on a promotional visit about 3 months ago or so. And the reason I was here is to find out what was happening in New Zealand. I mean, were the people in New Zealand ready for Twisted Sister? That's what I had to find out. I mean, I knew we were ready for New Zealand, but was New Zealand ready for Twisted Sister? Now, I hear this is a pretty crazy place. And I hear that the headbangers in this country are real rowdies, if you know what I'm talking about. And we're gonna get crazy tonight.
Phrase, the music business is a business. If you think it's fun and parties all night long, then you're going to get burned. And those are the stories that you hear about when bands get taken advantage of and they wind up on the slag heap of life, drunk and stoned out and have no money. From the beginning, we realized it was going to be a long haul. And why that is the way it is, I can't tell you. I think we realized that in order to stay alive, you have to position yourself for the future all of the time. And you do that by, I guess, always planning ahead, so we always manage to plan ahead. And all the people out there who consider the band to be a bunch of lecherous, devil-worshipping heathens don't understand that while we live and we believe in going out and doing a show which makes people climb the walls, which is the essence of rock and roll, behind it there is an awful lot of responsibility that takes place, which runs again counter to what is normally accepted from a heavy metal band.
Is there an aim to make people climb the wall?
When I was 13, 14, 15, I started to go to the shows. One thing I remember was coming home blown away. I mean, having that thing in the back of your spine just flipping out and just going crazy. And I remember when I got in my first band, I said, I want to do that every single night to whomever is coming to watch me. And whether or not I may get jaded, later on in my life is not the key. The key is if you ever lose that desire, ever lose that edge, you have no business being in this business.
How do you keep that edge?
Well, personally, I do running and I work out all the time. I ran a marathon in 1981, which was purely on a bet. One day I just picked up a magazine, I read something about marathon, and I said, who the hell runs 26 miles? This is crazy. So the guys in the band said something like, yeah, right, you think you could do it? So I bought a magazine, and in the magazine, as a matter of fact, was an article on Alison Rowe. So I know about New Zealand. Hello, Rod Dixon. Hello, John Walker. Congratulations on your 100 sub-4-minute mile. I think that's fantastic. But I read this book, and so I followed these rules. And plus, we were playing every night, five nights a week, and I was running every day. And I remember the first day looking at this thing, I said, well, I have to run 2 miles today. I have to do a show tonight. Well, that shouldn't be too hard. But the 10th week, I had to do a 14-mile run and do a two-hour show. I mean, I saw my three-month schedule, and I said, how am I going to do this? And it just kind of happened. As every week went by, I got stronger and stronger and stronger. And the day I did my 14-mile run, we did a play the night before, got home at 6 in the morning, went to sleep, woke up at 2 in the afternoon, said, this is it. You know, went out, ran 14 miles, came back, took a shower, and went and did a two-hour show. And that is when I knew that I was ready to run the marathon. And Dee got married that weekend, so the whole band took a huge weekend off, and he went on his honeymoon, and I ran the New York Marathon.
Stay happy!
And around the same time, you had Eric Clapton in The Cream, Jimi Hendrix, and Jeff Beck. So those were the three real strong influences. Anytime they were in town, I always went to see the band.
Why do you think heavy metal has risen so much in the last little while and become so popular?
I don't think it was ever dead. I don't think it's... maybe there are more people who like it now because... there's some kids that are growing up now and just latching onto it. I don't think it was ever dead. It was bands around doing the same business they were doing years ago.
Yeah. Do you prefer to play in a studio or you prefer live?
Live. We're a live band. I think Twisted Sister, the guys in the band are all excellent, excellent musicians and could probably do just about anything, I think. But the band in the studio is very itchy and put us on a stage and we'll perform.
And what's the buzz about playing live? Why do you enjoy live?
Because it's a whole performance. It's a whole show. It's not just standing on a stage and playing an instrument. It's there's a lot of theatrics involved, some comedy. It's a very enjoyable thing.
Is there life after Twisted Sister?
As far as...
For you?
For me, I think so. Yeah, I think there's life for everybody after Twisted Sister. We're not looking at it like that. I think Twisted Sister is going to be around for a while.
Yeah.
that the most important element of rock and roll is that people listen to it to have a good time and have fun. And it seems that a lot of bands seem to lose sight of it. I mean, yeah, we're mean and aggressive, and yeah, it is aggressive and crazy, but bottom line, we're here to have a good time. The audience is there to have a good time.
Do you have to change mentally from the person that you are now to the on-stage image?
I go on stage and I go really crazy, shouting and screaming, rolling around on the floor, and by the end I feel very good. That's why when I'm off stage, I really don't feel the need anymore to walk around with a chip on my shoulder, angry at the world. I can get that anger out when I'm on stage, so I've really separated the two. A costume and a makeup has really been designed over the years to bring out that part of my personality. I mean, if you look at the makeup on this shirt, you can see how it's done. Now if you look at my face, I just realized this the other day, like my face, here we are, the face. I mean, if I go like that, I mean, all the makeup has been designed to look like it when I make a face. So once I put the makeup on, I put the costume on, it's very easy to tap into those negative emotions.
Don't associate something like Catholicism with heavy metal, but you're a Catholic. Is there any conflict there?
No, actually it's a plus because, a lot of boxers, a lot of baseball players, a lot of football players are Catholic. Before they go on the field, before they go out to the ring, they usually do the sign of the cross, maybe they say a prayer. That's what I do. And before I used to do that, I would have a good show. More or less, this would build up my confidence even more to go out on stage by saying an Our Father and giving the sign of the cross. And I'm not actually a practicing Catholic like I should, but when people come up to me and say, your band is into the devil, you're into the devil, this and that, I tell them if I was into the devil, would I have a picture of Jesus Christ on my arm, which that's what it is. All Italians, where I live in Brooklyn, Staten Island, always have, Christ, because the Italians are more into the Catholic type thing or anything else. But it helps me. It helps me out a lot. So you can mix it more, you know, your soul, your heart, some more into it.
What's happening with your drum kit? You're getting some new kind of deal there.
Oh, the new one next tour, actually I'm having it custom painted. I'd rather not reveal what it's going to look like because it's going to go along with the show. But I had this idea of there's about maybe three or four drummers in the world, Van Halen, Eric Carr from Kiss, that use four bass drums. Actuality, they're using two, and the other two are for show. I had come up with an idea, what would it sound like if I used four actual bass drums, where I'm using 226s in front as my mains and 224s on either side. You got the punch of the 24 and the fatness of the 26. So I had this drum pedal company design this pedal for me, where I can hit a 24 on my right with a rod that goes over, with just a cast and a beater on this one. Then I'll hit the 26 and the 24 with this one, 26 and 24 with that one. So I'll be playing, actually, it'd be four bass drums going at the same time. So it's...
And is that going to make a difference to, you know, the sound or...?
I don't know. I never tried it. And it's going to be new for me, too, because I don't even know what the pressure on it is also. Because one pedal working another pedal can also be a lot harder. So that means I'm going to have to get my legs back in shape by running 3 miles a day and doing that. But it'll be worth it, because if it sounds good, I will probably actually be the only drummer that's using that technique of playing. Which to me, to be first, it's something, because Buddy Rich and Gene Krupa and all these other drummers are taking credit for everything. I wouldn't mind taking credit for that. That would be nice.
Somebody's going to tell me that getting out your angers and frustrations without hurting anybody at a heavy metal concert, if they're going to tell me that that's unhealthy, then I'll tell them that they're fools. My father could have used a heavy metal concert once in a while. Because now that I'm older, I understand that he had his problems and his frustrations from work, having a big family, food, mouths to feed, bills to pay. And what happened is he would get very caught up and worried and frustrated, and he took it out on his kids. I mean, he beat us and he abused us, and I understand why. I don't excuse what he did. I mean, I probably wouldn't be the way I am today if it wasn't for the way I was treated. Now, maybe if my father had an outlet, a musical outlet or any kind of outlet, someplace to scream and yell and let out his frustrations, maybe it would have been easier on the children, okay? So, I mean, here are these kids who are growing up. And there's always problems when you're growing up. You're confused. You don't know where you're going. You get at that age where you're 17, 18. People expect you to act like an adult, that they treat you like a child, you know, that whole thing. And you've got a lot of frustration. You have a choice. You can either punch somebody in the face or you can punch your fist in the air at a concert. You can scream at your parents or scream at your teacher, or you can scream into the open night and not hurt anybody.
We're all ready if you want to start.
This is Auckland, isn't it? I said this is Auckland, isn't it? Well, Auckland, do you want to rock? Are you sure? Well, we're going to find out right now. Right now. We're going to find out. I got a word I want you to say. One word, a little word, an easy word. You already know the word, man. You know what the word is? The word is rock. 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 And this is when I want you to say it. When I say, I wanna rock, you say rock. I wanna rock, rock. I wanna rock, rock. Very easy. Trained dog could do that, right? I wanna rock. Woo, very good. Okay, okay. Get ready now. I want everybody on this. Everybody. Is here tonight. This could be one of the hottest right here. Get ready. I ain't BSing you, man. I'm telling you the truth. You are loud. Do it again. Do it again. Everybody, come on. All right. Stop playing. That there's too much space between the band and the audience these days. I mean, it wasn't so long ago that we were out in the audience banging our heads just like all you out there, you see? So what we like to do when we play, we like to do this every night. We like to turn off all the stage lights and turn on any and all of the house lights. Please! Do we have any more? No music, no lights, no garbage, just Twisted Sister in Auckland right here. Here we go. Here we go. Get ready. All right. This is hot. And we got people everywhere screaming and shouting, but some people are screaming and shouting, and they're sitting down. Oh, I was gonna blow you out of the water, man. The guy just stood up over there. We have anybody left sitting down? No.
Oh, over there. I found them. Too stoned to stand.
Oh, wow, man. I snuck some of this weed, you know? And I'm just so blown out, I can't...
Well, you come to a concert blown out all the time? Radio man, this is heavy metal, and you gotta be alive for heavy metal! Throw your fist in the air. This is gonna be on TV, man. Get ready. I'm talking to my friends in the back too. I want everybody. No attitudes. Here we go. Like that. And as far as I'm concerned, I think that stuff is all blown up, if you know what I'm talking about. Nobody's hurting nobody. We're just having a good time. Are you having a good time?
All right.
We
got to tell the rest of the heavy metal bands in this world about New Zealand, man. All right. Now, yeah. Okay. Every time I say I want to rock, you say rock. Every time I say rock, you say rock. Rock. All right, my friend. Hey, don't sit down. Don't sit down. What are you, tired? Go home now. If you're tired, go home. If you ain't tired, stand up and party, baby.